Finding Sarah, A Duchess's Journey to Find Herself, by Sarah Ferguson, the Duchess of York, narrated by the author.
This book is dedicated to Oprah, who pulled me out of the darkness, and my dearest Andrew, who holds on to the real Sarah, and of course, with all my heart and soul, to my magical two beautiful daughters, Beatrice and Eugenie, who remain true and steadfast to their mummy. My dear reader, to love oneself is the beginning of a lifelong romance. Oscar Wilde. More than a year ago, my life was so off course that I wondered whether I would ever be able to find my way back. I was in the gutter, no question. I had suffered the consequences of a bad decision, made without careful reasoning. I had flung myself into a mess, unthinkingly, like someone who dives into a pool without checking the depth. I found myself walking around asking, why was I even living? I was broken and lost, not even sure where I was. But out of this emotional barrenness, I knew I had to find me. And so I took a journey to find myself and begin the process of healing all the broken places. Finding Sarah is the story of that journey. There is a reason I have chosen to share my journey with you. There was a time in my life when I would have been paralyzed by the adversity I've experienced. But I have come to understand that a terrible experience, though difficult at the time, can become a source of strength and courage. While it is my journey, it is also yours. I honestly believe that if you and I were to sit down together, it is likely we would discover more things that we have in common than things which set us apart. In listening to my story, you might say, oh, that feels like what I've been through. So many of us, though we may not admit it, have lost ourselves at one point or another, whether through divorce, loss of a loved one, addiction, illness, depression, or some other life trauma. And somehow, someway, we must find our way back. It is never too late to find a new direction, realize a dream, or take back control of your life. On any journey, there are people you meet who enrich your experience more than the places you visit. I had amazing guides, real-life angels, who shined the light on the dark parts of my life and helped me find my way back. I met them during the taping of my docuseries, Finding Sarah, and you will meet them on every page of this book and learn from them, as I did. They are experts who help me understand the source of all my problems, from comfort eating to self-loathing, from reckless overspending to the notorious mishaps I habitually find myself in. But there are other guides, too, my friends and family, who offered me support and wisdom along the way. And I include bits of their guiding wisdom on these pages as well. I believe that some of the most loving, wise advice comes from those who know us well and love us even more. Finding Sarah is not a self-help book in the traditional sense, nor is it a how-to program with steps. Rather, it is my attempt to inspire you, through my own experiences, to think about how nagging aspects of your own life may be holding you back, then to encourage you to follow your instincts and find your true path. As it turned out, Finding Sarah segmented naturally into 32 parts. Significantly, the number 32 in my spiritual practices represents truth and how to live it. Finding the truth of who I am is at the heart of my journey. As I wrote this book, both who I am and where I've been became clearer to me, more defined. I've seen where my life took wrong turns. I can point to places where I changed, the events and people who taught me the meaning of joy, and the steep hills where I felt the burden of despair. When our lives are in harmony, we have an instinctive sense of the right direction. We can move steadily ahead through life without fear of getting lost, knowing that through the storms and uncertainties, we shall come to the right place at last. My hope and prayer is that you'll find that right place in your own life, as I'm beginning to. Life is a work in progress. Love, Sarah. Chapter 1, Lost. I can't believe I created such a merry hell. Once upon a time, I was a princess, married to a handsome prince and living in a palace. But then the fairy tale began to unravel. I got divorced, started my life over with two young daughters, went broke twice, and watched my life be brutally sensationalized by the international press. I never imagined I could live so unhappily ever after. As I write this, I am immersed in extreme personal turbulence, and I'm trying to buckle up with whatever remains in my emotional and spiritual resources. The facts are these. In May 2010, my life spiraled into a private hell when I was caught unawares, on a hidden camera, accepting money from a tabloid reporter posing as an Indian business tycoon who supposedly wanted to back my various business ventures. The whole mess started innocently enough when I began looking for investors willing to put their capital in my business and help me rebuild a loyal following for my books, merchandising, and other enterprises. One of these projects was to build a girls' school in Afghanistan. Any business that needs investors or financing is usually required to produce a business plan, showing information such as financial reports, projections, and the company's goals before receiving funding. I had a business plan, a strong one. Even so, my business had suffered in recent years because so much money had been taken up with paying wages and past bills. A repercussion of this mess was my inability to pay the wages of a longtime friend and trusted staff member. He needed that money to pay for his college tuition and room and board to the tune of $40,000. I wanted to help him. In my own defense, I've always been a great one for giving. I played Santa all year round. I never saw my generosity as a fault. I got such a high from showing friends what I thought of them. It was almost addictive with me. I craved the appreciation and approval that came from pleasing other people. It was always about buying everyone's affection. I had to be the best fun, the most generous, because obviously no one could like Sarah for who she really was. As for keeping my businesses alive, I had no idea how I would come up with the money, since at the time I was seriously about to go bankrupt. Financial rescue seemed in sight when my friend, the person who could not make his college expenses, and I learned that a mutual friend of ours could introduce me to an investor who would help me. The mutual friend told us that this individual was a successful, well-known businessman from India who worked for a prestigious conglomerate of companies and that he wanted to back my projects. And indeed, when we checked, there was such a company that did have this person working for them. He was legitimate, he came highly referenced, and by all accounts, he was for real. Optimistic, I agreed to the introduction. From that point forward, everything was set in motion. Irrevocably so. I first met with this businessman at the Mark Hotel in New York City. I asked him to sign a confidentiality agreement, to which he agreed, and he would sign at the next meeting. Several days later, I asked two of my assistants to retrieve the signed agreement. He had not signed it, however. He curled it up and said, "I just need to give it to my lawyers." I smelled a powerful, foul odor that best can be described as dead rats in the basement. My instincts told me not to do it, that it wasn't right, that I couldn't trust him. Despite twinges of something amiss, I said to myself, no, because this agreement would mean I'd be able to meet my needs and take care of the people who were important to me. I recklessly ploughed forward. Back in London, I texted the businessman to have dinner with me at Mossman's, a fancy wood-panelled restaurant in the shape of an octagon. Ironically, the building was once a 19th-century church, a place originally intended for peace and spiritual refuge. When I arrived, I asked him if he'd signed the confidentiality agreement. He said, "I'll do it in the morning." I felt he might be waffling, but I went on with dinner anyway. Over a meal of pea soup, a main course of lamb and vegetables, and a bottle of burgundy, we discussed how our business venture would play out. After we finished eating, the man paid our dinner tab. I jumped into a limousine with him to travel to what he claimed was his flat in the trendy Mayfair district of London. During our meeting, I mentioned in passing that by doing business with me, he might get to meet Prince Andrew because the prince and I are a team. Under no circumstances did I offer to broker an introduction to my former husband, as it has been claimed. I love Andrew.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.